What types of ecosystems are actually relevant for building with nature designs? If we talk about flood risk reduction as the main function, we automatically focus on systems that occur on the boundaries between land and water. The type of ecosystem that occurs there depends on the abiotic conditions. These conditions set the boundary conditions for ecosystem development on different scales. If we look at a very large scale, the first variable that determines ecosystem development is temperature. For example, most mangrove species do not tolerate below zero temperatures, and reef-building corals can't tolerate water temperatures below 18 degrees Celsius. Temperature is also reflected by latitude, and here the climatic zones Arctic, temperate, and tropical can be distinguished. If we zoom in to a more detailed scale, the main determinant of ecosystem type is whether we are in fresh or in salt water, as many species do not tolerate high salinity levels for long periods of time. Then, the most important factor is whether the system is sheltered and dominated by fine sediments, or exposed and dominated by sandy sediments. In temperate zones along sheltered coasts, marshes can establish. Along sandy coasts that are characterized by high wave impact and low nutrient availability, marsh grasses cannot grow. Here we find our sandy beach and dune systems with their own characteristic species assemblages. Finally, within these systems, submergence time is crucial. Where regular submergence under salt water is a stress for plant species, it is a requirement for oysters, mussels, and corals. These different factors, temperature, salinity, exposure, and submergence time, determine the type of ecosystem that will develop. This means that you cannot create any ecosystem wherever you want it, simply because you cannot control all these factors. In the same way, you cannot control how effective an ecosystem is in performing your design function. But we do know that coral reefs are really effective in breaking waves. Seagrass beds, on the other hand, are generally subtidal and more effective for protecting sediment against erosion. So, the effectiveness depends on ecosystem and species characteristics, like the height and the biomass of vegetation. So now back to the design. Wave attenuation and erosion protection are functions of ecosystems that you can use in your designs. For example, oysters construct an oyster reef, and in and on the oyster reef, a whole assemblage of other species will live. So pay attention to the first colonizers. Then you should be specifically aware of what are called the keystone species. The keystone species are always pretty crucial for ecosystem functioning. The term originates from architecture, where for big arches, there's a single stone in the middle that holds together the entire arch construction. If you remove this stone, the arch collapses. Similarly, for keystone species, if they are removed from an ecosystem, for example, due to diseases or to overfishing, the ecosystem collapses. Often those species fulfill a crucial role in the food web, and they are mostly not the top predators, but they are, for example, a herbivore. Good example of a keystone species are urgents on coral reefs. Algae also live on coral reefs. They can overgrow and smother the coral. Fortunately, urgents graze on these algae, keeping the coral clean and healthy. But you can see the problem. If we overfish the urgents, algae become dominant on the reef, smothering the corals and killing them. Then, last but not least, please pay attention to the size of the ecosystem. Not only from a hydraulic perspective, so how extensive does it have to be to achieve a certain amount of wave attenuation, but also from an ecological point of view. Larger ecosystems are inhabited by more species, and so are more diverse and more stable. So I have talked about biodiversity, productivity, stability, and resilience, properties of ecosystems. You now know that ecosystems are dynamic, evolving through succession, and that the types of ecosystems relevant for hydraulic engineers generally lie at the margins between water and land. When designing in these environments, two things are crucial. First, to know the abiotic conditions, and second, to understand their implications for ecosystems. Thank you for your time and attention.